Welcome back to latest TV news. To see or not to see? That is the question. There are 37 Shakespeare plays, and one man plans to see every single one this year. Is this a good idea? Or is it much ado about nothing? I didn't write that link, I promise. Well, Dan Wilson joins me in the studio. Dan, you took the decision to watch all 37 Shakespeare plays in one year. Why?
For no particular reason, but the idea came to me on my 37th birthday, which was last October the 21st. And I was thinking, what are there 37 of to do in that year? And the first thing that came to my head was plays by Shakespeare.
Well, it's lucky there wasn't 37 Ibsen plays or Chekhov plays, because that would have been incredibly depressing.
Well, I wouldn't have known that. It was the first thing that came to mind.
So, which was the first one that you saw?
I saw Julius Caesar at Lewes Town Hall, put on by some sixth form drama students there. That was my first one.
Now, you obviously liked Shakespeare before you went into this. Having seen, what have you seen, 35 so
34.
Far? 34 so far. Do you like him more now or less?
Oh, much more. I mean, the thing was, I realised, I thought I was quite an avid Shakespeare watcher. I thought I'd seen quite a lot. But as it turned out, I'd hardly seen a sort of fraction of his work, you know. There's a sort of division of things, aren't there? They're the greatest hits, Macbeth, Hamlet, As You Like It, all of those. Romeo and Juliet, You Can't Move for
Much Ado About Nothing.
All of those. Measure for Measure, not so much, but then you get down to the sort of second division, and then there's this level of plays that they seldom do at all, you know, and that's why Henry VIII, which most people have never heard of Shakespeare's play Henry VIII, that's why I'm having to put that on myself on Sunday.
So you wanted to go and see Henry VIII, but you've had to actually stage that yourself,
yes,
haven't you? Because no one's doing a production of it.
This year, no one's doing production, as far as I can find anywhere in the world. There was a read-through in Texas, in Dallas, Texas, in February. So I'm doing it on Sunday here in Brighton.
So where is it going to be?
We'll be doing it upstairs at the Grand Central pub near the station. We've got a script in hand cast. We've got a good team, the Droll and Folly Theatre Group have doing me a massive favour by being my cast. So we're going to have fun, I hope.
That's fantastic. So which is the how far have you had to travel in order to watch?
Well, thus far I travelled to Rome to see the Comedy of Errors. I didn't know, for instance, that they have a Globe Theatre in the Villa Borghese Gardens there, just as we have in the South Bank in London. And they put that on. There were a few Comedy of Errors around, but I couldn't make them, so I ended up going to Rome for that, which was nice.
And did you not go to America to see one?
I'm going to America on Tuesday.
What are you going to see in America?
I'm going to go and see Pericles. So it was on in Guildford, but I managed to miss it by going to the wrong church. So and that was back in sort of April, and then I haven't been able to find one that sort of fits exactly within my personal year. So I'm going to see that on my birthday next Wednesday. What's particularly cross-making is actually the Globe are putting it on come the 19th of November, but that wasn't inside my rules, so I figured I had to in for a penny, in for a pound.
So out of the ones that you've seen, do you have a new favourite?
Well, Othello, I think. I want to see a fantastic production in the Lyric Hammersmith, by a brilliant company called the Frantic Assembly, and they played Othello as if it was set in a north of England pub. And I'd never seen it before, so as it gets to the end, I don't want to spoil it for anyone, I was literally at the edge of my seat, gripped. What is going to happen? And it was terribly exciting.
But you'd obviously seen Othello before,
no,
I presume.
No, never
so
read
you'd
it.
Never seen it before.
No.
So what sort of hidden gems did you discover? Because as you say, you've got the greatest hits. You've got your Macbeths and you've got your Shakespeare and your Hamlets and all that kind of stuff. But out of the ones that you were less familiar with, which are the ones that you think people really should read?
Well, I think firstly people should read any of them, you know, rather than not read them, which is the starting point. But I think ones which I was blown away by that I hadn't considered. One was Titus Andronicus, which is seldom performed, which I saw in London. It's a really good play. And in the comedies, Merrywives of Windsor is a little bit unusual. Don't see that so much.
No, you don't, do you?
And it's very, very funny.
Taming of the Shrew is one that doesn't seem to get many outings.
No, I saw that in York with a two-person cast. I'd quite like to see a proper full-scale production, that, actually.
So when you decide which ones to see when, is it a case of looking for the best production of that play, or is it literally a matter of timing? This week I need to see Macbeth, Hamlet and Coriolanus, therefore I will go around the country and see it from these productions.
Yes, I mean, there's that, and I do have other things to do, like work and life and things. So there are pragmatic concerns like that. If you take it on a very practical basis, that you basically means you have to see one every 9-point-something days over the course of a year. So I had quite a slow start. So sort of around the new year, I've just started booking almost anyone I could find. But I did go to Stratford, been to the Globe quite a few times. There were quite a few one in London at big theatres. But then it's been almost finding the only productions, you know, Troilus and Cressida. As far as I can see, there are only two productions in the country this year. One was in St Albans and one was in Worthing. Guess which one I went to, you know.
But why? Why do you think something like Troilus and Cressida isn't as well shown and as well known as something like Hamlet and Macbeth?
Well, with the case of Troilus and Cressida, it quite simply isn't as good a play. I mean, it's quite a complicated play. It's based on a poem and a medieval poem. So it's just not as good. It doesn't have that, you know, something like Hamlet or Romeo and Juliet. They're real dramatic gems. They are top plays. Troilus and Cressida just doesn't have the same sort of cachet, I don't think.
Are you ready for a bit of a Shakespeare test?
Oh, I keep getting this. I will have a go.
I haven't actually prepared anything for this. It's off the top of my head. Which show had Laertes in it?
Laertes is in Hamlet.
Correct. What's the name of the Duke from Measure for Measure?
I don't know. I'm not seeing that till Saturday. Well, no, I'm seeing that at the Globe.
I think he's just called
the Duke.
I think I'm probably leading
Duke
up the garden path. From when till when did Shakespeare write his plays?
Well, I mean, there's a lot of... We can argue quite a lot about this. This keeps academics going. But 1613, probably his last. And then something like 1590 for the start.
What do you like about Shakespeare's plays? Because you're obviously somebody that really enjoyed them. You say you enjoyed them all. A lot of people that would be doing this challenge would be sick to the back teeth of them by now. But you're obviously somebody that has really taken them on board. Why? What is it you think are so good about them?
Their universality, their relevance, their modernity. I mean, there's currently in the States, someone's translating Shakespeare into modern English. And I'm thinking, well, it's already in modern English. What they mean is they want to translate it into contemporary English. And I find that slightly bewildering. Because you end up with, so, you know, that famous line becomes, Romeo, why are you Romeo? And it just doesn't have the attraction. And I think that, you know, what Shakespeare represents is that tremendous moment when English became the dominant language, if you like.
He invented something like 3,000 words.
Well, I think it's more than that, but I question whether he invented them. I wonder if he reported them. If, you know, London was an exciting place, people coming from all over the world, and I wonder if actually there were words being used and he just wrote them down. I think anyone of his talent would have been a great listener. You can imagine him listening out, you know, spying and earwigging conversations for nuggets of dialogue. So I wonder if he invented them strictly.
Now, in terms of productions, and you admittedly have seen some of the best productions in the world this year, possibly some of the worst too. You must have seen some pretty ropey Shakespeare, because Shakespeare, when it's done badly, is done really badly.
I'm not going to name and shame, but I did go and see one play where I really couldn't quite follow what was going on. So I was very grateful for a crib sheet on what the plot was. But to be honest, the standard's been very high. I mean, of course, you go to Stratford, to the RSC, you've got world-class Shakespeare, but you pay world-class prices for it as well. But what's quite nice is in some of the amateur productions, which have been extraordinarily good, you know, those are £8 and £10 tickets. So that's affordable. And it hasn't been, nothing has been terrible.
But what do you think makes a good production of Shakespeare?
I think you've got to have some It's, you have to tell the story, and you have to give it some sort of imagination, gild it somewhat. So one brilliant production I saw was, it was the all-women Titus Andronicus, and that was just so stylistically performed, it was a joy. Others used music and dance, where that might not, which is probably quite realistic to how it was done in back in the day. And then, of course, sometimes it's just, you know, the stories themselves are just so engrossing that, I mean, no one can do A Midsummer Night's Dream badly. It's too lovely, it's too frothy, and that's the joy of it, I think.
Is there one, very briefly, is there one play that he wrote that you think, oh, that was not his finest piece of work?
I thought anything was dreadful yet. I'm slightly, I did find sitting through the three parts of Henry VI quite a long experience, let's put it that way.
So you've got two more to go until
three,
you've completed
three.
It. Three more to go. And you complete it in, what, a week's time?
Yeah, less than a week. Next Wednesday.
It's been a joy to talk to you. Thank you very much.
Cheers.
All's well that ends well. Well, that's about it from me here at Latest TV News. We'll be back at 6 o'clock and throughout the night here on Latest TV. But stay with us. We'll have more news, sport and entertainment throughout the night. And we'll be back at the same time tomorrow. But from me and all the team here at Latest, bye-bye and thank you for watching. We'll be right back.